Thank you, everyone, for joining me again. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick, one half of the award-winning World Footprints podcast team. The other half, my husband, is practicing a little bit of social distancing at home, and so you just get me again. And today we're actually going to travel to Vancouver, Canada via Cape Town, South Africa. And, you know, when I started this this video interview series a little while ago, I started with the intention, one, to share how we're all going through the same thing around the world, no matter where we are. And two, as a way of connecting us, allowing us to connect while adhering to the guidelines imposed for health and safety. So we're connecting today with my very good friend, Kellie Paxian, who also happens to be the editor of World Footprints. And she's done a fabulous job curating some wonderful articles for the website. And Kellie just got back by the hair of her chinny chin chin from South Africa to Vancouver. So Kellie, it's really good to see you.
Thanks. It's great to be here.
You know, you were cutting it very close. South Africa closed down. It went into lockdown the day after you left to come back home to Vancouver, Canada.
Yeah. And it was just a coincidence that I had booked that flight too. Like when I booked it, I didn't know the country was going into lockdown. So I had, I think, like just over 24 hours to spare, or I would still be stuck there and the borders would be closed. So it's crazy.
My goodness. So I know the continent of Africa is really the last continent or one of the last continents to be impacted by COVID-19, the coronavirus. And so it really wasn't necessarily, you didn't leave out of urgency at the time you did. But when you did leave, and because the country went into lockdown the day after your departure, what was the state of the country? What was going on in, you were in Cape Town, so specifically Cape Town, before you left?
Yeah, so I've kind of been watching the virus like tighten its grip from afar. Like I've seen my friends and family, and I've seen online what's going on around the world. But in Cape Town, it was like relatively carefree for quite a while. Like, but I knew that when it hit, it would hit really hard because of the state of South Africa. So I was like kind of toying around with the idea. I was like, do I stay in quarantine here? Like, do I want to go home where right now the numbers are much, much, much worse? Like, I think South Africa just got its first case when Canada was already like in the thousands. So it seemed kind of bizarre to go home where it was worse, but I just knew it would get there. So yeah, I eventually booked my flight, and it was just starting to get like, you could see it more and more, like less and less people were out, more people wearing masks, people are encouraging hand sanitizer. So yeah, it was starting to get pretty noticeable by the time I left. And then the next day it was just, right now they're all in lockdown, so no one can leave their house for non-essential purposes.
My, and so what did you come home to? What is the state of Vancouver at this point?
So I'm so, so, so fortunate for so many reasons in this, but a big part, I mean, I have like an amazing support system. You know, my parents like picked me up at the airport, brought like my mom's car for me to jump in, and I didn't make any contact with them or anything. And my family, we share like a summer home with my aunt. So that's actually where I'm here right now. So I'll be here for 14 days by myself, just self-isolating. But I'm so lucky to have a place where I can go and not be putting anyone else in danger. Like Canada has the Quarantine Act now, which actually it's mandatory for us to self-isolate for 14 days. It's not just encouraged. So yeah, I can't be around anyone else for 14 days, even if I have no symptoms. So I'll be here just hunkering down for 2 weeks.
And I know when we spoke several weeks ago, actually a few weeks ago, and I sent you a text, and I said the US and Canada have closed their borders to each other, or the US closed their borders to Canada, because initially I thought you were going to fly through the United States.
Yeah,
and
it was,
so
yeah.
How were you able to pivot and change your flight so that you wouldn't have to come through this country?
Yeah, well, props to Turkish Airlines, because that's who I was flying to LA with them. And they actually moved my flight one day, because first I called them and I was like, can I change this? And they're like, no, we'll have to like give you a credit. And I was like, that's not really ideal for me, because I just don't want to have like this much money tied up with an airline that who knows when I'll use again. They changed the date of my flight, so then I was able to just cancel it altogether. So then I would that was just a relief, because it meant my money wasn't tied up with any certain airline, so then I could kind of like get home whichever way was best for me. So from then I kind of like toyed with it for a bit. I was like, I want as few layovers as possible, because I don't want to be going to all these international airports, you know, where the chances I might get stranded in some of them. And I also don't really want to go through countries that I'm not familiar with, or I don't speak the language. Like a couple of the layover options were in Hong Kong or in Istanbul. And that wasn't a really appealing option to me. I didn't want to get stranded there and just be so out of my element. So I was able to book a flight with British Airlines Airways through London. So that's where my layover was last night. So I was in London for 10 hours, and I at least knew if my second flight got canceled there and I was stranded there, like I have a support system in London, I speak the language, it would be more familiar. So I just felt a lot better about that.
And how did the airline then deal with social distancing? I mean, were you guys spread apart on the plane and in the waiting areas?
So coming from Cape Town to London was a gong show. Like, because the country is going into lockdown the next day, everyone was wanting to get on whatever flight out they could. So the flight was full. It was packed with mostly like Europeans, I think, just going to London as their hub. And then like I was surrounded by a group of German people. So I think they would go to London and then fly. There was no like direct flights from Cape Town to Germany, maybe. So social distancing there was really tough. Like it was crazy. Everyone, a lot of people were wearing masks. Like it just kind of felt like coronavirus was like in the air, and like you didn't want to get too close to anyone, but you were all like sardined in the plane at the same time. So yeah, it wasn't great. And then in London, the airport was like still like more full than I would have expected. But then my flight from London to Vancouver was pretty empty. I guess like everyone has either made their way back over from there, or yeah. So I had like, there were empty rows like all around me.
And so when you landed in Vancouver, what did you have to go through? You know, does customs have any checks, medical checks, or how did you get through?
Yeah, it's weird, because I've talked to a few people who flew like much earlier than me and like weeks before, and they said that their temperature got checked, but they didn't check anything on me on either of my flights, like didn't check my temperature or anything. But when we landed in Vancouver, the staff was all asking like, how are you feeling, and there's signs everywhere saying like that we'll have to self-isolate for 14 days. And then at the customs official was like telling me the Quarantine Act rules and telling me that I'll have to self-isolate, and asking like, do I understand, or I'll face the penalties of like a pretty significant fine and like possibly jail time. So the vibe was definitely intense there.
Oh, like, known. Wow. Okay. Yeah. Well, that's good. They're taking it seriously.
Yeah.
So, I know you know, you just landed recently in Vancouver, so you haven't been home really enough to, and you really haven't had that much interaction with your family to understand how the changes that they've adopted in order to cope. But I'm sure they've shared stories with you. So what have they done in order to get through the restrictions placed by this pandemic?
Yeah, it's funny, because obviously I'm self-isolating and I know that the best thing we can be doing is quarantining ourselves. But even like my dad and my brother's workplaces haven't like closed down the offices yet. Like it's not like everything here is on lockdown by any means. So I literally haven't been outside at all. So I don't know if there's still like people walking around and stuff. I think some businesses are still going on as usual. I think a lot of offices are also like working from home. My family is like my parents are staying home, working from home. And then my brother has two young children. So they're staying home as well and totally social distancing. So I think they're doing like what they're supposed to be doing.
Sure. And when you left South Africa, you know, I know that the virus was trickling down and people obviously were concerned because of the crowds trying to get on planes heading yeah. out elsewhere. How did people behave, and did you see communities being built or acts of kindness being offered, even though it wasn't as critical at that point as it is here?
Yeah, totally. Well, I was staying in a hostel called Atlantic Point Backpackers in Cape Town, and it already has like such a nice, like homey kind of like family feel to it. But we've been putting in like a lot of measures, you know, like the owner is putting in hand sanitizers and lots of like new cleanliness measures to keep everyone safe and healthy. And then once we found out it was the lockdown, the hostel just let everyone know that like if they're stuck here, the hostel is happy to be like a safe and clean oasis for them to just kind of like stay for those 21 days. They're saying like, don't leave. You have a room here. You know, you can stay mm-hmm. here. You'll be safe. So people didn't need to freak out about like where they were going to stay or if they're going to get kicked out. So that was really nice. And then another friend of mine has like a tour company there with, he does like tours in vans. So he transformed those vans into like delivery trucks for hand sanitizer. So they were bringing something to the townships and kind of raising awareness that way. So yeah, I definitely saw some businesses taking steps to make people more comfortable. And I guess now the country's on lockdown, so there's not a lot of movement happening, but yeah, definitely stepping up.
Mm-hmm. And now since you are self-isolating, you know, you've been used to being around people for the last couple of months since you've been away. What creative ways are you finding to connect with others, your family, your friends yeah. that you left in Cape Town? How are you connecting with them and maintaining sanity?
Yeah.
Because you're alone right now.
Yes. I mean, this is day one, so talk to me on day 7 or day 14. But I know what I'm in for. You know, it's not a shock to me that I'm going to be self-isolating. So I know this is like a time to really like dig deep into myself, like find ways to self-motivate. There's so many like projects. I'm a digital nomad anyways, like I work online. So I think this is the time for me to really like work on my passion projects and like make some things happen that maybe I've been putting off. I'm definitely FaceTiming with everyone. There's this app called House Party that where you can do like multiple video calls. Like I want to use this time to really connect with everyone and see what I can do. I want to do like a daily dance challenge or like work on some yoga, like write, do a lot of writing. You know, I think this is the time when we can all kind of like develop new hobbies and just find out like how we can motivate ourselves to like get through these really weird times.
Yeah, indeed, right? So are you, I mean, you may not have had enough time to really feel the pressure of this virus yet, but what do you normally do when you're stressed, when you're feeling anxiety? How do you de-stress and how are you likely to use those methods during this time?
Yeah, I mean, well, obviously, like I find exercise is really relieving, and where I'm right now, I'm just kind of surrounded by nature. So I will be able to like get outside, get some fresh air, go for a run or do yoga or something. And then other than that, yeah, I want to find ways to like feel like I'm still working towards my goals and like achieving what I want to do in terms of like travel content and stuff like that, until I can go on my next trip.
Mm-hmm. And that begs the next question. So after this pandemic is over, certainly when you're out of self-isolation, what's the first thing that you might do or the first place you'll go when all is said and done?
Well, it's going to be really hard for me not to just go straight back to Cape Town, to be honest, or at least more of Africa. Like I really wanted to do more of Southern Africa, like check out Namibia and Botswana. So I know I'll be back there so soon. Like Cape Town just has my heart. So I'll be back there as soon as I can. But my plan originally was to go kind of create a little home base in Bali for a bit where there's a lot of digital nomads. So it's kind of good for people like me who are just looking to broaden their network and see what other opportunities are out there for remote workers. That was my plan. So yeah, hopefully Bali will still happen. You just have to take it day by day. I certainly won't be booking anything anytime soon.
Now, do you think that the industry though, you know, for our industry, I mean, you're in a different place than we are, but do you think that this is going to change the opportunities going forward?
In terms of like travel writing and travel content?
Yeah, and earning.
Yeah. Oh my God. It's going to impact everyone. Like I say, I'm so fortunate in so many ways. And like, one of them is I find that there are opportunities to create travel content out of this pandemic. Like, you know, we have stuff to talk about right now, and a lot of publications are still commissioning. But a lot of my friends aren't so lucky and they've already been laid off, or if they're directly in the tourism industry, like it's looking really bleak right now. So I mean, we'll have to see what happens. I think we'll be able to travel again, but it's going to be a bit of a tough recovery for a lot of companies. Mm-hmm. And we'll just have to be a lot more conscious of, you know, how we're keeping safe and healthy while we're on the road and traveling.
I just want to back up to one thing that you said, and you talked about South Africa having your heart. Why is that? What is it about South Africa?
Well, you've been to Cape Town, right?
I know. I have my reasons. I'm curious as yours.
It's just the best. I feel like I can live my best life there. Like, I feel like so free, and I think Cape Town is like such a little gem in like the bottom of Africa. It's not what you would expect. It has everything. Like, if you want to be adventurous and outdoorsy and be in nature, you can do that. If you want to be a bit bougie and go for like some bubbly on a rooftop, you can do that. I love the people there. I love the vibes. Like, now I've been 3 times, and this past time was for 3 months, and I just can't get enough. I feel like I'm eating good food there. I'm getting lots of exercise. Like, I'm breathing that sea air. I'm like hiking the mountain all the time. I think it's just like, it just has my heart.
And what about Vancouver? And you know, as you might know, Vancouver has our heart. So what do you
Vancouver's great.
I love Vancouver, right?
And you know what? It has those things too, to an extent. Like, I don't know. I'll have to see where my life ends up. I think I've been in Vancouver my whole life. And right now I'm looking for something a bit different, a bit different from what I'm used to, and a bit more like, I guess you could call it off the beaten path, but looking for like something that feeds my soul a little bit more than just like the ordinary day to day that I've grown up with my whole life. So
we'll see. Understand.
Yeah, but I love Vancouver, but
make sure you just, you know, you make a pit stop through Washington, D.C. on your way back. Well, Kellie, thank you so much for joining us. I'm so happy that you made it back home safely, that you're healthy, that your family is okay. And I really appreciate, I know you are incredibly jet lagged.
I still am. I don't know what day it is. I'm like, I need a nap.
I know. Well, and so I appreciate you even more knowing that you're knackered beyond belief. And so thank you.
No, thank you for having me. I'm doing nothing else, so I'm happy to chat anytime.
Bless you. And thank you to our audience for joining us wherever you are. We pray that you're safe. We pray that you're healthy. And that when this is over and everything is said and done, that you'll get back out and travel this big, beautiful world of ours. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick, one half of the award-winning World Footprints podcast team. And I thank you so much for joining us.